Good morning. I would like to begin by acknowledging that the land on which we gather is the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe people. The Algonquin peoples have lived on this land since time immemorial. We are grateful and honored to assemble on this territory today. Welcome to Orleans United Church, to all of you who have gathered here in person today, and to all of you online. I'm not sure which camera I'm on, but hello. Welcome to all of you. This is my first Sunday on my own up here. I am unsupervised. We're gonna have a little bit of fun today. That's right. I also would like to extend our prayers and well wishes to Dave Clemis, who is one of our LLWLs, our licensed lay worship leaders, of which we have five? An ever-growing group of LLWLs. And Dave is, and those folks are licensed, trained preachers who have ministry that they do for us here at Orleans United Church, but also out around the region. And let me tell you, as somebody who, from time to time took vacation at my former churches, licensed lay worship leaders were a real blessing to the various churches that I have served. And Orleans United Church is known for having many and well-qualified LLWLs. So to Dave, who's out at Castleford, Glasgow United Churches, and to all the LLWLs who are here today in the congregation, you are a blessing, all of you. Thank you for your work. Yeah. Let us share in an invitation to worship. Each day is a gift from God. Each day is a reminder of the new covenant. Each day we draw closer to God. Let us worship together, and let us pray together. Great Spirit, receive our prayer. We come seeking your understanding and your compassion. As nomads, we come seeking, wandering through the waste of a society that celebrates the lives of the famous while ignoring others whose lives are scattered on the debris of a wanting world. Come seeking your understandings and compassion. Nomads all, we seek the knowledge found in the message that tells of a realm of compassion that opens up a new way of being in which all are cared for, valued, and respected. We come seeking your understanding and your compassion, Great Spirit. For in you we live. You breathe life into our very being. Open us to your mindfulness, Great Spirit, that we might be your blessing in this world. Amen. Our opening hymn today is number 229 in Voices United. For those of you who are visiting, Voices United is the big, thick book. More Voices is the thinner book. We're going to use Voices United for this one. God of the Sparrow.
God of the sparrow, God of the whale, God of the swirling stars, how does the creature say ah? How does the creature say praise?
the kids, young ones, young at heart, if you'd like to join us up at the Discovery Garden for our time together today. Hello, how are you today? Well, I'm going to tell you why I have a beach ball. I have a beach ball because it feels like summer has started. Almost. Are you still in school right now?
Yeah.
Yeah? You're still in school?
Yeah.
How many more days of school do you have? Have you counted how many more days of school?
Four.
Four more days of school. You know, it's time to get ready for summer. And one of the things that I do and did when I was a kid was I like to play a lot in the summer. I like to play outside and I like to play ball. So I got myself a beach ball, but it has been so long since I've played with the beach ball that I've forgotten how to play with the beach ball. Isn't that sad? Yeah, I know. I need some help.
You just need to throw it around to somebody and then they throw it back to you.
What do you need to do?
You need to throw it to somebody and then they throw it back to you.
Thank you for teaching me about ball. Would you like to play what you just mentioned to me? Would you? Okay, so I'm going to take this ball, this beach ball, and I got a beach ball for a reason. I have memories of dodgeball that I don't want to bring up in church. The ping that a dodgeball makes. Ugh, shivers. Beach ball.
Why do you have a microphone?
Because I want to hear what you have to say. So I'm going to take this ball and I'm going to throw it to you. And can you throw it back to me? Okay, I'm going to sit back a little bit. All right, so this is one game we can play with the beach ball. Okay. All right. Okay. If I throw this to you, will you throw it back to me? Okay, it's the trust building exercise here. Are you ready? Okay. Can you help me with ball?
Don't throw it very high.
Well, you know what though? You came and you got it, and I think that's okay. Thank you very much. So that's one game that we can play with the ball. What's another game we can play with the ball? What do you think? What's another thing we can do with this? Anybody have any ideas? Another game we can play with the ball? Okay, buddy. You're about to find out why we have a microphone.
We play baseball using the microphone in the beach ball.
What do you think of that, Dave? Oh, he's saying maybe not. Okay, well, all right. You had the idea. So kind of like baseball, if I take this ball and I sort of toss it, waft it up in the air,
do you think you could pretend like your arm is like a bat? And bearing in mind that we're inside, return this ball in this general direction. Do you think you could do that?
Maybe.
It's a good answer. Okay, you ready? All right, batter up. So we played throw the ball back to each other, and now we're playing. All right, you ready? Are you sure? I'm not sure if I'm ready. She what?
She takes softball.
You play softball. We have a ringer. All right, here you go. All right. You ready? I'm really not confident in my ability to throw this. All right, ready? Excellent. All right, one more. We need to come up with one more game that we can play with the ball. Any ideas? One more game we could play? Yes. Why, what a great answer. Thank you for that. Would you like to try to throw the ball into the bucket from a distance?
No.
You don't want to do that? That's okay. It's all about our comfort level here. Who would like to try to throw the ball? Would you? You want to try it? Okay. Now, okay. When I bought the ball, I thought it was going to be easily going to the bucket. But my spatial recognition is not all that great. But we're going to try, okay? We're going to try.
I'm going to put the bucket.
I'll hold the bucket. And, oh, you're ambitious. All right, let me stand up. All right, ready? Yeah? All right, go. Oh. All right, you want to try it one more time?
I think it would have worked if the ball
was smaller. Let's try it one more time.
No.
Do you want to try throwing the ball in the bucket? Okay, well, that's far enough, buddy. All right, did everyone all right? Yeah, watch. Heads up, everybody. We're going to try this. Well, there, it worked. Well, I'll tell you what, you probably know this is coming. I know you know this is coming, but this ball reminds me of God. Why do you think this ball reminds me of God?
What do you think?
You talking to the microphone?
Because it might have memories of God.
It might have memories of God. Well, I'll tell you what, I was
thinking about God when I blew this up. So maybe it does. All right. Why do you else think that this ball reminds me of God? Any ideas? What's the shape of the ball?
A circle.
A circle. And what's special about a circle? Does a circle have a beginning and an ending?
No. I don't know what that's supposed to mean.
No. Do you think a circle has a beginning and an ending?
No.
No, God's love for us has no beginning and ending. God loves us forever. What does a sphere remind us of?
Any ideas what a sphere reminds us of? What's made of a sphere?
A circle.
Mm. A circle is, well, part of a sphere is a circle, yes. I'll give you a hint. What are we living in right now? The world, that's right. Yeah, it reminds me of God because God loves the whole world and everybody in the world.
Earth is a circle.
That's right, because the world and the earth is a sphere and God loves the whole world and God's love has no beginning and ending on us. God loves us forever and ever and ever. Yeah, we might want to take the bucket and do something with the bucket. Thank you very much. Thank you.
You know what else reminds me about God in this ball? Has anybody just spent hours and hours and hours and hours and hours playing with a ball by yourself?
Yes.
Yeah?
Is it more fun to play with somebody else?
Yes.
Absolutely. And I think that's like God too. It is important for us to talk to God when we're by ourselves, especially if we're afraid or we're sad, or maybe when we're happy and we want to thank God. I think that's something that we can do. God always wants to listen to us. But I also think it's a lot of fun to share God's love with other people, just like this ball. You know, I could have just sat here and played with a ball up there all by myself, and you would have watched me and go, oh, so it looks like he's having fun, but I'm not. And it was a lot of fun to share that with you. So let's pray about that. Yeah, well, next time I'll get a smaller ball or a bigger bucket.
Let's let's have a word of prayer.
A smaller ball.
I think a smaller ball. How about we say a prayer? And then I believe we have Sunday school today. We
Yay.
Do have Sunday school today. All right. Let's pray. Repeat after me, everyone. Dear God, you love me so much. Your love has no ending for me or the whole world. Thank you for being my God. And thank you for helping me share you with others. Amen. Amen. Now, we are going to Sunday school. We'll see you later. Well, we are. You are. I kind of wish I was. Thank you very much. And our hymn is number 703 in Voices United. In the bulb, there is a flower.
Thank you.
Let us pray. To come into holy presence is not to come without wonderings about why some things are the way they are. So come to us in our wonderings, God of Sarah and Hagar, companion us. To come into holy presence is not to come free of conflict within our own lives and relationships. So come to us in our tensions, God of Isaac and Ishmael. Untangle us as we receive your word today. Amen. Our reading today is from Genesis chapter 21, verses 8 to 21. Picking up in what has become an unintentional sermon series about Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Ishmael, and Hagar. The Lord dealt with Sarah as he has said. Do I have the right reading? Oh, I got to go to verse 8. Sorry. The child grew and was weaned. And Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman and her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning, and he took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder, along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite of him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite of him, she lifted up her voice and she wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Don't be afraid. For God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then she opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went, filled the skin with water, and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up and lived in the wilderness. He became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. Let us listen for the word of the Lord within these words. Amen.
The musical reflection today is from More Voices, and it's a hymn that we haven't actually sung here, but that Mike called our attention to this week, and it's quite a beautiful one. I'm going to sing it as a solo, but if you figure out the tune by, you know, second or third verse, the words will be up on the screen, and feel free to join in. It's called "Like a River of Tears." like a river of tears. Your love pours upon us like a sunshine, a blessing. Your grace will sustain us like a star-studded sky. Your Spirit shines o'er us, renewing our spirits with courage and faith. Like a bird in free flight, by windows around us, like a wind in the forest that breathes life among us, like a phoenix that's rising from ashes around. With vision and grace. Like a pillar of cloud, you promise to guide us. Like a bright fiery bush, you come to speak to us. Like a calm, cooling breeze, your Spirit breathes in us, renewing our spirits with loving embrace. Like a lover's caress, your Spirit revives us. Like a song of the soul, you come to be with us. Like a prayer of the heart, you heal and restore us, renewing our spirits, the to face. Like a prayer of the heart, you heal and restore us, renewing our spirits, the future to
thank you, Scott. What a pretty song. Thank you. Well, we're not going to let the kids have all the fun. No. We're gonna play a little game amongst ourselves right now to kind of ease our way into our dealing with this piece of scripture. If there's a theme to this scripture, this sermon, it's themes, emerging themes. So I want to try some themes out for you and see if you recognize them and see if you can find a connection between them. So we're going to play a little game of Name That Tune. So Dave, would you play clip number one, please? Name That Tune. No, it's not Dynasty. Who said Dallas? It's Dallas. Give him a round of applause. All right. Dave, would you play clip number two, please? Somebody say Dynasty? Dynasty. There you go. You got your Dynasty. Congratulations. Dave, would you play clip number three, please? There you go. You say it again. Say it again. Say it again.
Beverly Hills
90210. See, I'm being intergenerational here. Which one are we at? Dave, would you play clip number 4, please? Grace and Anatomy. Again, playing the generational card. Dave, would you play clip number 5, please? Who said Succession? All right, we'll talk after. Succession, okay. What do you think the emerging theme we're looking for here is? What's that?
Family,
sure, okay. Competitiveness, yes, for sure. Family, competitiveness, especially with Succession, am I right? Yeah. Absolutely. What else?
Drama.
Dave, could you play clip number 6, please? I just threw that one in there. For no particular reason at all. Family, competitiveness, drama. Dysfunction. Soap. Don't read anything. The last one was a joke, remember? Soap operas, the stuff of entertainment. And scientists tell us that these shows, these programs, these stories work for a couple of reasons. One, we like to engage with people we recognize. We get hooked on it because we recognize the people and the characters, and we get invested in them. So that's one reason why these stories work. A part of our brain, that reptile, basic part of our brain, doesn't know the difference between TV and real life. That's why it works. That's why it works. Another reason why we engage in these programs, and they are so popular, is because they hold back. Now, there's intrigue, and there's drama, and there's awfulness in it. There is death, there is adultery, there is all sorts of terrible things, but they hold back. And I know that's true. I know it's true because of the life that I've led, and you know it's true because of the life that you have led. Truth is stranger and often more terrible than fiction. There are some things that I've seen in my ministry, working in and amongst the prisons in Kingston, presiding over so many memorial services and funerals, hearing people talk about their stories. I would think to myself time again, you don't ever see this on TVs and movies because people wouldn't believe it. That's why those shows are so popular, because they hold back. The Bible doesn't hold back. That's why some scriptures are hard to engage in. That's why some shows are hard to engage in. A theme I did not play in that montage was The Handmaid's Tale. How many of you have read the Margaret Atwood book, The Handmaid's Tale? How many read the follow-up, The Testaments? Oh, good for you. If you've read The Handmaid's Tale, do yourself a favor and read The Testaments. You'll thank me for it. How many have seen the program? Yeah. Is it as much fun as the other ones? No, it's not. It's a hard watch. It's bleak. I think it's an important show. Margaret Atwood said, yes, it's a fictionalized version, but of real things. She said that what happens in The Handmaid's Tale happens in real life in some way, shape, or form somewhere in the world. She didn't make it all up. Perhaps it's not as popular a show because it's harder to watch, and it should be hard to watch. Scriptures, I think, sometimes should be hard to read. This is one of those stories. Now, we've had a little bit of fun over the last few weeks with the story of Abraham and Sarah. I loved learning about Terah, Abraham's father. And last week, Molly had a wonderful sermon about Sarah laughing, you know, and we all identified with Sarah. I think we all identified with her because we've all been desperate before. Make no mistake, Sarah was desperate. She was desperate to have that insurance policy, that investment of a family, because that would have been her security. That was her legacy. Never forget that women had a disadvantage in these times. She needed a family. And this family would secure her position within her community and perhaps her very life. She was desperate. So is Abraham. Desperate to have his own offspring, his own legacy that would continue on this promise of God for him and for the collection of individuals that he had, as the scripture put it, acquired over the years. These were desperate people. They were desperate times. It called for desperate measures in the form of a woman named Hagar. I've never intentionally read the story of Abraham and Sarah and Hagar and Ishmael and Isaac through Hagar's point of view as The Handmaid's Tale does through June's point of view. So let's consider Hagar's story from her point of view for a few moments. Hagar, the name means flight or forsaken. She was an Egyptian slave. Now, as we know, Sarah, Abram's wife, bore him no children, but they did have an Egyptian servant named Hagar. And so an arrangement was made, and Hagar was a surrogate for Abraham's son, promised because Sarah could not have children up until that point. So after Abram had been living in Canaan for 10 years, Sarah, his wife, took her Egyptian servant, Hagar, and gave her to her husband to be his wife too. And she conceived a child when she knew that she was pregnant. She began to have problems with their mistress, between Sarah and Hagar. Ishmael was born. Sarah wasn't happy. And so she was sent away to live in the desert, Hagar was. "Your slave is in your hands," Abram said. "Do whatever you think is best." Abram cast her out. And Sarah mistreated Hagar, and so she fled from her. The angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was the spring that is beside the road to Shur. She was promised that she would be the mother of a great nation, paralleling God's promise to Abram, though. The angel said, "I will increase your descendants so much that they will become too numerous to count." And she was brought back into the household. But then she was sent out again, as our story this morning tells us. Abram gave her a little bit of food and a little bit of water and set them out. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. And she was desperate. Desperate for her life, desperate for her son's life. This would be hard to watch in a TV show. People starving, potentially dying of thirst in the desert because of a horribly abusive system. And yet, God provided for her in the wilderness. They settled there. And God was with the boy as he grew up, and he lived in the desert. He became a great archer. And then eventually, Hagar, Ishmael, found a new community, and a wife came along, and a great nation was born. So great, in fact, that we still know them today. The Bedouin tribes that gave rise to a fellow by the name of Muhammad. Our cousin faith is Islam. Sprung from this story. The theme is drama, competition, pain, suffering. It's hard to read a story like this. And yet, in the midst of it all, there is a grace. God provided for Ishmael, God provided for Hagar in the midst of their desperation. it's essential to understand from the story that there are abusive systems in this world, and there are people who are trapped in systems that are meant to keep the powerful powerful. That's true, and we should know that. We should recognize it, and we should rail against it. But it is also true that there is a God of grace at work in the deserts of our lives. And just as there was water for Hagar and water for Ishmael, there is water for us, water for you. Even when we are too parched to pray, God experiences our tears. And God is close to us in the deserts of our desperation. The story teaches us that no matter where we go, God is there. It reminds us that God is often not there in ways that we might have hoped or ways that we might have predicted, but it reminds us that God is there. I am sure that all of you who have found yourself afraid and all of you here have found yourself desperate at one time in your life. And I hope and I hunch that somewhere in that desperation, somewhere in that sorrow, God has interrupted it with grace and perhaps even the idea of hope that sprung into a well that brought about a great nation of new hopes and dreams for yourselves. It is easy to get caught up in the sadness of some of these stories. And yet at the root of them all, there is a God who inspires hope. I hope for us all here that for the next time we find ourselves sad or lonely or in a difficult spot, we will identify with Hagar. That as we cry our own tears, we will identify with her story and we will have reason to hope for a God that will come through for us too. Note when it happens. Remember it. Share it with others. Hold on to it fast. And you will find yourself never alone, even though you might find yourself No, you will find yourself in deserts again. Amen. We're going to sing. Oh, I got so caught up in that, I forgot what our next song is. Don't Be Afraid. More Voices, number 90. So for those who are visiting, More Voices is the smaller book. Lifting up the ministries of the church. And while Dot is on her way up, to the lectern. I'll lift up a few of my own here. Donations for Camp Awesome. Camp Awesome is just weeks away. It's a lot of fun. But we do need some baked good donations. And so any questions you have or any offers, please direct them to Reverend Molly. It is the beginning of summer office hours this week as well. So the office will be open Tuesday to Thursday from 9 until noon, and the regular office hours will resume at the end of August. And I'll just repeat an announcement from last week. They are looking for research participants for a study, and that is also part of your Orleans this week. This is a friend of Molly. Her name is Reverend Lori Stevenson, and it could be an interesting opportunity for folks who'd like to help out in that. And I think Dot's going to talk about the next thing I have highlighted. In fact, I'm pretty sure of it. So, Dot.
I know. I'm wearing the part. Okay. But he would be wrong if that's my first announcement. My first announcement has to deal with the joy of being part of a vibrant church, one that's full of renewal and busyness. And I would like everyone to look at Ron Hunt. I would like to let you know that he is our traffic cop for all those user groups that are coming in. He is spending an inordinate amount of hours here on all of our behalf. So let's say thanks to Ron Hunt. So, now let's talk golf. Rain, sun, heat, smoke? Okay. Make your choices. If you need to step back from golf today, certainly understand. Just let me know so I can manage the tee times moving forward. The barbecue is always a go. 4:30-ish. Address is in the newsletter. Everyone is welcome. Smoke and Joe is sitting in the back from Tap Room 260. Donated time is here. You're invited. Everybody's invited. And bring a lawn chair if you can. Thank you.
Thank you, Dot. Do we have any other announcements? No? Okay. We will continue to worship by celebrating and dedicating all of our... Oh, what else? Oh, there's a concert today. At 3:30, as it happens, here at the church. So details are on the board. Thank you, Dave. And now we'll continue to celebrate and dedicate our gifts. Halle, halle, halle. Gracious God, we bring our gifts this morning, amazed and gratified that they are considered worthy of your use. Bless these gifts, O God, and bless us in the giving. Amen.
Alle, alle, alle.
Holy and gracious God, God of the desert, God of the desperate, God of Sarah, God of Hagar, we thank you for your grace and we thank you for your blessings found in unlikely places, yet in abundance. We thank you for this place in which we live, for the richness of this land, for the indigenous stewards of her, which we have inherited and partnered a legacy of stewardship. Thank you for this day, this opportunity to gather in this place, to share companionship and community, to ruminate upon your word, and to celebrate in your presence. We thank you for all the activities in and around this building and this congregation. We thank you for all the blessings that we enjoy at home and with our own families and with our own circle of friends. We pray for a world that is often and in many places desperate and hurting. We pray for the air that we breathe. Concern for those with difficulties in this season of smoke. We pray for those who are on their own desperate flights from oppression and rickety boats in places both near and far. We pray for the people of Ukraine and the people of Russia in a tumultuous, violent, and unstable time. Closer to home, we pray for ourselves and for those in our own families who are suffering, who are coping, who are recovering, who are facing difficult diagnoses and treatment. We pray for Gord's sister Jan, who's had a stroke and a heart attack. We pray for her and her whole family. We pray for those who are lonely. We pray for those who suffer from invisible illnesses like anxiety or depression or addiction. We pray and we pray and we pray, and you listen and you listen and you listen. Even if our prayers are simply feelings or unformed thoughts or tears such as Hagar's. And so God, we are confident, or perhaps we are emergingly so, when we come to you in this quiet moment of silence to share with you our innermost thoughts and prayers. And in your way, and in your time, and as always in your love, we faithfully pray you answer as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Mother, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. This is, oh my goodness, you're going to hear me say this about a lot of hymns, but this is one of my favorite hymns. Wherever you may go, More Voices number 216. I'll tell you why it's one of my favorite hymns. Do you think you know why it might be one of my favorite hymns? Yeah? Anne-Marie, why do you think this is?
Because David Kye wrote it for the
Renaults. That's right. Yeah, yeah. Because David Kye wrote it for the Renaults at a time and talent auction, and it became a gift not just for them, but to the entire United Church of Canada and the other denominations who use this book as well. So, number 216 in More Voices.
Side by side.
shall join together in our commissioning and benediction. Go in peace. Trust in God's promise. May the God of Hagar and Sarah bless you. May the Christ who redeems uphold you. May the Spirit who sustains disturb you. Let the people say, Amen. Amen.